everybody, and welcome to this local television programme coming to you from Father Ryan Hall, Macroom, here today, Sunday afternoon. And we welcome you all very much indeed, and we hope you'll enjoy the programme. We're here to give you a bit of music, and we're going to start off now with a selection of reels, and the first one being the Shaskeen reel.
Thank you.
Then we have a little song for a change this time, and we'd like to do a nice local song for you. It's entitled Mount Methy, the floor of Matrobe now. We'd like to introduce to you Johnny, that has been with us a little while now, a couple of months, and Johnny has been a great addition to our band. So we'd like to feature Johnny today on a couple of his own specialities with the fiddle. So over to you now, Johnny. Thank you.
we won't ask them if they're ready to come along and join us, please. First of all, we have Karen Toomey, I think it is. Karen Toomey and Helen Whelan. So would you give a nice? And they're going to do a slow jig for us. Now, I'd like to introduce Helen and Karen, first of all, by telling you that there's no into the middles. They have hanging up at home and trophies and all that goes with it. They're both All England and All Ireland step dancer champions. So I think you'll see what I mean in just a moment if you'll just bear with us and keep your eye on their feet. Right, girls, what would you like first? A slow jig.
Thank you.
Hunter's Grant. Hunter, also, there's no shortage to the medals and trophies that those Lions girls have, and I've seen them with my own two eyes. They could fill his hair down with medals, I think. Near enough. Good girls yourself. Well done indeed, girls. Right, what have we next on the list? Oh yes, we have a small man now, and he'll join us to give us a little tune on the accordion. He's my own little boy, Jim Murray Jr. So come on, Jim, please, and we get a couple of bits of music out of Jim.
Thank you.
you there now again, would you be ready for another bit of a step for us, good girls?
Thank you.
the evening, and with time pushing on, I suppose we'll have to be concluding ourselves in a moment, but there's a lot more entertainment to come, so we'll finish off this particular session now with a selection of reels again this time.
Thank you. from Sandra to play a section of Hornpipes and Real Spear. So a big hand to Tim Joe.
Thank you. Allegory Choir will give you a selection of Christmas carols. We're going to start off with Once in Rwandale City.
Come through, sometimes moves around.
Our next carol is called On a Christmas Night.
Thank you.
name from Kill the Marcher, and Dermot has got to tell you a few yards. Right, Dermot?
Yeah, well, I find myself in a kind of a half position actually, because it has had to stop telling yarns after singing Christmas Carol. But no matter, we'll try, we'll do the best we can. I suppose I'd be quoting Ned Kelly in a way, and a lot of things I'd be saying because they happened in my father's time. And even Kelly, the others, just as about his father's time. So like, that's why I'm kind of speaking about tonight. Because the lifestyle in Ireland have changed drastically with the last 60 years, admitted, and a lot of it was from the good and from the very good. But maybe a lot more of it mightn't be for so good at all. And I think that if we had a lot of the old style dancing back in the houses today, the house dancers as they called them, that it might be a very, very good thing. And just the story I was going to tell about Johnny and Mary, you see, Johnny was going to Mary for a couple of years later. He used to give her a call down every Sunday night, you see. And they'd be going to the neighbour's house to the dance. And Johnny, there's across the speed every Sunday night, you see. And this was carrying on Mary for about 6 or 7 years. And that man Mary was getting very tired of it because he wasn't popping the question as hard as he had. So this night, anyway, Mary, she said she might as well say something. And she said, we should Johnny, she said, will we be walking across this field long more? Well, not too long at all then, Mary, is sitting on your flute this year. But anyway, eventually, with a lot of old pushing, nudging and pushing like the law, she gathered them away as far as the awful thing here. But you get to know, things went grand, they got married and everything, but of course, like the modern style today, like there was no going to Tenerife or the Canary Islands or thing like that, there was out. But anyway, they went home. Maybe had a drag in a punch near the fire or something, they went to bed. Oh, no need to go to quarter the limb of the fish, and nudge Johnny like that. And she said, Johnny, she said, hey, fierce cold. Hold on a fight, said Johnny, do not. Believe me, think you would know there's a pair of blankets out there in the war hall. My mother gave them to us as a present, you see. Johnny hopped out a bit and anyway, got the pair of blankets. I'm in front down the bit, went away to bed again. Got after another beast and she called Johnny and she said, Johnny, she said, hey, you're awful cold. Can I hardly do no, says Johnny. Do you know what? He said, I'll run down and get heat a bit of a hot water bottle for me. He said, there's a hot water bottle below in the cupboard. Don't be Johnny anyway, keep the water body, brought it up, put it on her feet, went into bed, tried to sleep away again, poor man. God help us, poor Johnny. After about another 10 minutes or a quarter of an hour, she said, do you know what, Johnny? She said, for name was at home and go, and when next to say it was cold. My mother, she used to always put her arms around me and cuddle me. God knows, says Johnny, your mother was 5 miles away from here. Johnny. And he said, there's no, just born a cat in the morning. Even though I shouldn't have taken me up the pony and trap, he said, I'd take you back to your mother. Lay down there and go back to sleep, Rosa. So, like the Bishop of Kelly, this is one of the Kelly Arnold doers in. Because, like, the Bishop of Kelly, when he was giving confirmation back in Dingle, you see. And the Bishop, Mary, Katie and Tom, they came down that pony and dropped over the mountain like to listen to the Bishop's sermon, you see. He was talking away for a long time. God, he gave a fierce long sermon. There was a long time in the church and everything. They're doing a few messages in the village then. And they're going home and that kind of way. But, you know, he touched on a point of subject. One thing he started talking about anyway was sex relations. So, poor Katie was very pushy about him. She didn't know anything at all about him. But they're going up for a walk anyway, and the pony and top messages and all got going away home for themselves. She said to Johnny, Katie said, we should do you know what? Tom, she said, come here to me. There was something I went to ask you. But Katie, he said, do you know what? He said, she said, who are all sex relations? He don't not care to go there. He said, he don't care. He said, but you know, there's one thing he said, he didn't see any of my children. What is going on?
Thank you.
favourite comedy sketch from Michael and Marty Linehan, which they had great success and score last year with. So a big hand for Michael and Marty Linehan.
Well, sir, women were always in the church. They always had a big part to play in the church. They were trying out all floors and rushing out the floor and trying out jobs. And there was a priest and a bishop in the country from the day he was ordained to the day he died, but he had a woman on trial. Every lady won him.
Leal, the church sisters, I ask you, but what about a woman and her role in the home? Man folk usually describe woman as gossipers outside the home. Personally, I never repeat gossip. So listen to me the first time. We hear what it is a schoolboy called Montrose has to say.
And when I was, here's awkward in the home there. I remember when I was 9. That was just before I was 10. And my mother burned my feet in it. She was ironing my socks. But she brought me a cake puppy, she did. But she bought me a black and white one. Seriously though, women are fierce awkward around the home because the house, they're very romantic. We're always getting married and things like that, and we don't do them at all. But I'm more or less awkward than anything else, if you know what I mean.
Romantical sisters, I ask you. Speaking of romance, I had a snippet in the Independent recently, and a couple coming home from the honeymoon. When the wife pleaded for her husband's affection, said, "Nobody loves me, my hands are cold." To which he replied, "Sure, God loves you, and if your hands are cold, sit in them." But what about women in agriculture? We hear what a poor farmer from Vin Rome might say.
Pardon me, Nell, but I heard you talking. I don't know, have women any place in farming at all? I mean, we're getting on there fine, Miley and me. Except when that old match comes along, she's very awkward to know. But at the same time, I wouldn't agree with women being around family at all. Sure, young Miley, there wouldn't go because there was a woman around the place. When you got the mountain for the sheep in the morning, there's no fear the sheep come down the evening anyway. I heard that this woman once up in farming, and she wanted to keep her calves in, so she put on this bad boy of gaiters. But anyway, she didn't know the difference in the calves and the gaiters. I don't agree at all.
A man complaining about a woman, and he was saying that she was one who insisted that her husband take off her boots after coming in from the farm, despite she hadn't vowed before they got married that she'd kiss the ground he walked on. Another man was telling me that he used to keep his wife under the bed. It seems he used to think she was a little patty. But what about a woman and her role in sport? Can you imagine, sisters, for a moment, an All-Ireland final played solely by a woman and the reaction of thousands of male spectators? This is how a reaction by Micheál Murarrichy might sound.
Dear me, the father, and welcome everybody to this great All-Ireland final played here in Croagh Path. But this is an All-Ireland final with a difference, and that is the first All-Ireland final played solely by women. And we joined them in the second half, the old rivals, Cork and Dublin. August, ta, a 4-foot hot woman running up the field. Ta, she agreed, who from Park will be aboard in the live kit? But she's been followed by 2 7-foot Dublin women weighing 235 pounds each. And now as we look at her from this angle, she's been pushed and forward and knocked to the ground. And ladies and gentlemen, this is the first time in an All-Ireland final where 10 or 12 women gathered together to form a scrum in the middle of Croagh Park. and now I see a Red Cross ambulance making its way up the field with a box of posies for later little emergencies. And strewn on the ground we see dozens of necklaces, bracelets and false eyelashes. Ladies and gentlemen, this will surely be a day for Ireland.
Are women taking seriously any longer, sisters? Not judging by Morris Alarty in a news bulletin last evening, and I quote,
three women won from wind plastic surgery today and the bags taken from under their eyes. Gordy described it as a daylight robbery.
Speaking of respect for women, is the day of chivalry gone, sisters? I was only coming out of the bus the other evening, and I was sitting next to this man, and I saw these three ladies standing on the bus. So I says to your man, would you think you'd get up and leave one of those ladies sit down? And he says to me, and he's looking at my generous figure, wouldn't you think you'd get up and let all of them sit down? Next week, sisters, we'll devote our program to ridiculing man folk. Remember, sisters, one good turn gets most of the blanket. Good night, sisters, and God be with you.